welcome to part two of the album reaction for Red. In this particular portion of the reaction video, we're going to have a bit of an odd disconnect. We're going to be going tracks 11 through 20 of the Taylor's version of Red. So we're going to hit the end of the original version, and we're going to get into the first part of the additional tracks that were released in 2021 when this when the Taylor's version came out. So let's get right back into it. This is Holy Ground, track 11. I was reminiscing just the other day while having coffee all alone, and Lord, it took me away back to a first place feeling on New York time. But when you fit my poems like a perfect rhyme, took off faster than a green light go. Yeah, you skip the conversation and you already know. I left a note on the door with a joke we'd made, and that was the first day, darling. It was good. Never looking down. And right there where we stood was holy ground. Ooh, tonight I'm gonna dance like you were in this room. But I don't wanna dance if I'm not dancing with you. One thing I do want to mention is that I am recording these reaction videos days apart. I'm not just chopping up the video arbitrarily. I'm actually stopping and then reacting to the rest of the album days later. Since I recorded the first reaction video for part one, I have had the song Red stuck in my head. It's the first genuine earworm of this reaction series that I just find running through my head over and over. I'm wondering if this one is going to do that too. This is the first song I recall reacting to where I really took note of the background vocal arrangement and how she's using counterpoint with almost like a call and response or just a sort of a doo-wop kind of background that's significantly different from the lead vocal that's occurring. And I think this is her pushing further and further into the more pop-oriented realm. She's approaching, I mean, this is nowhere really close to R&B per se, but she's inching in a direction which has some of these multiple influences. And I think that's great. This is a bright, poppy type of soft rock song that you would love to play cruising down the highway. And it's such a poignant, beautiful, lighthearted song about a relationship that didn't work out, but you're choosing to think about all the good stuff. And basically saying why we were in this relationship. This is where we stood was holy ground. It's a nice metaphor. And it's just a solidly constructed lyric and just a great song. If I were her, I would have released this as a single.
How little they mean when you're a little too late. I stood right by the tracks, your face in a locket. Good girls, hopeful they'll be, and long they will. We had a beautiful try to listen. Hang up, give up, and for the life of us, we can't get back. What a sad end.
I love about that song is several, well, there's several things I love about that song. First is the smoky vocal delivery. To me, the first thing that comes to mind is, I can't remember her name, I think it may be Margot, the lead singer of the Cowboy Junkies. I felt that sort of energy on the or maybe, you know, Mazzy Star is also another name that pops into mind. Alt rock, 90s, late 80s, 90s music. But I hear Taylor really doing things with her voice on this album and matching her voice to the song, as opposed to, in addition to matching the instrumentation to the song, as opposed to putting everything into a cookie-cutter singer-songwriter template and relying on the lyrics to carry the song. There's a real growth here of fleshing out the song by using different vocal approaches. Second thing I love is her confidence in her songwriting to give such a straightforward narrative in the song and trust that she can pull off making it a really captivating song. Most people trying to write a song like this would end up just driving off, well, to use her analogy, just going off the train tracks and into complete banality and greeting card type sentiment. Simple words, simple concepts, but still laser focused on capturing that feeling, and it's still engrossing for the listener. So I really appreciate that a lot. Another thing about the songwriting is that it also walks the line very nicely between the more general type of songs that aren't full of rich imagery, and it inserts little pieces of imagery, like the opening line about the long note deep in your pocket. Immediately you have a visual to start off the song, and there's other little tidbits thrown in. It's generally speaking more about concepts about, you know, broad emotions that she's having, but she inserts just enough of that detail to really give you a sensory experience with it as well. And I love the internal rhyme of tragic and magic. It's not often that people think about, except maybe rappers, it's not often that people think about rhyming songs in different lines, because by putting them in the same place in the middle of the line, I mean, it's an easy thing technically to pull off, you know, but it's not something that people are usually thoughtful enough to even to try to do. And then the juxtaposition of the magic and tragic, these are not $10 words by any means, but they're effective, because we all know how it feels when something is magic, and we all know what it means for something to be tragic, and the juxtaposition of those, and again, it's just the confidence that she feels using these simple words and concepts to build a song, and trust that her innate songwriting ability will carry it through. And it really does, because this is this to me reads like, listens like a funeral dirge for a relationship. And she nails the emotion in the song, both through her delivery and through the lyrics, and of course the instrumentation as well. I'm not sure if she was being mischievous by putting track 13, unlucky 13, and calling the track the lucky one, but that seems like something Taylor would do.
Figured out.
Man, another home run of a song. The obvious comparison point here, and I'm sure it's one that Taylor had in mind when she was writing the song because she's very pop culture aware, is Britney Spears' song, Lucky, which is almost the exact same subject matter. I love that Britney Spears song, and it's perfect in its own way. But this song shows how you take a concept for a song and then you elevate it by adding pathos to it and adding some songwriting techniques that just take it to another level of meaning. And here, that is not only the extra detail that she provides in spinning this narrative about this star, but the fact that you kind of don't know in the beginning, and it's the same way with the Britney Spears song, is she's writing the song in third person, or in second person, in this case, and so you think she's talking about someone else, but is it really just a biographical song? And whereas you never get that resolution in the Britney Spears song, so it remains perpetually up for discussion, here, in the last verse, Taylor ties it together by explicitly acknowledging that she is talking about someone, but it's someone who came before her, and now she's in the same position as that person. And that adds a poignancy to it, and also flipping the meaning of the chorus by saying, well, they told you you were the lucky one when you were on the way up, but now that you've taken the money and run and you have your life, you got what you needed from this situation, and now you are out of the spotlight and not subject to the pitfalls of celebrity, and you have your comfortable life, now you really are the lucky one. This is what I like about Taylor a lot, that she doesn't hide from her privilege. She doesn't pretend like she's a regular person when she's not anymore. And she's writing a song about it because it is her experience. She doesn't make apologies for the fact that she has super extra first world problems. And she addresses those head on. Like, I was such a big fan of Mean because she addressed people head on who said that she couldn't sing. I also liked the military drum beat instrumentation, sort of which brings to mind the regimented nature of having to, march to the beat of the Hollywood drum, or the media circus or what have you. The fact that you're constrained, the fact that you have to do things a certain way in order to conform to people's expectations.
We good to go?
All I knew this morning when I woke is I know something now I didn't before. And all I've seen since 18 hours ago is green eyes and freckles and your smile in the back of my mind, making me feel like I just wanna know. You better know now. I just wanna know. You better know now. I just wanna know. You better know now. I just wanna know.
You better know now. All I know is a new fire.
Everything has changed.
So that song obviously was featuring Ed Sheeran. I feel kind of the same way I felt about the other duet. I didn't so much like the other duet. I like this one a lot better. But I do feel that in both cases, this really feels like a concession to the style of the duet partner. In the other case, I felt like that was more a Snow Patrol song. In this case, I felt just sort of the jangly, playful guitar rock of Ed Sheeran. And again, Ed Sheeran's style isn't so different from Taylor that they couldn't be confused from each other from time to time. There are points of convergence there. But this, to me, felt kind of more like an Ed Sheeran song. But it was beautiful. Their voices sound great together. I just didn't feel like there was quite as much lyrical meat to this song, and it doesn't quite fit into the rest of the album as well for me. But in the sense that maybe this is something fresh and new emerging out of the heartbreak that she's been talking about song after song throughout the album, then, you know, it definitely can have a place in the album. It's just that it is a divergence, and it feels more so like a song for the song's sake as opposed to being really strictly speaking about any particular experience that Taylor Swift is having. And I guess I've just trained myself to crave that personal connection to what's going on in Taylor Swift's mind when I listen to every single song. So part of me is a little disappointed, regardless of how good the song is, if I don't quite get that connection. I love the fact that there's a hook to the song that is different from the song title. I love when that happens, because you have two things to latch on to. And in this case, Everything Has Changed is almost like an afterthought, or it's definitely a secondary hook in the song. I've always been a sucker for songs where the title isn't repeated a million times or isn't really the focus of the song, but maybe just a snippet of a lyric that's particularly important in the song. And this is that for me as well.
What a marvelous tune. It was the best night. Never would forget how we moved. The whole place was dressed to the nines, and we were dancing, dancing like we're made of starlight.
A cute song. From the beginning, there was so much detail in the song. This was clearly a narrative song describing a night that she spent with someone. I guess it's placing herself in a fictional situation. I assume by 45 she meant 1945. So it sounds like she was placing herself into a narrative where she was a certain character or a certain person. But because of that rich detail, I was expecting some sort of big payoff in the song, something at the end that would take my breath away or make everything tie everything together in a Dickensian way, but it never happened. So the song kind of left me a little meh, you know. There's nothing really profound or different being said in the song. It does capture the feeling she was trying to capture. So, not my favorite, but not a bad track.
Took a deep breath in the mirror. He didn't like it when I wore high heels, but I do. Turn the lock and put my headphones on. He always said he didn't get this song, but I do. I do. I walked in expecting you'd be late, but you got here early and you stand and wave. I walked to you. You pull my chair out and help me in, and you don't know how nice that is, but I do.
Just the simply stated lyric, a couple of snapshots of the prior relationship, and then a fast forward to the new relationship and some vignettes showing how she got that spark back. And like, this is a great way to end an album about heartbreak. And it seems like the last three songs were about looking forward into more hopeful types of scenarios. The Ed Sheeran song was about just a pleasant romantic situation. The second to last song was about a fantasy or reliving a night out that for, as a character or another person, it seems like. And then this was obviously a very autobiographical song. There were enough details there that you knew that she wrote this from personal experience. And that part in the chorus where she says, I thought love all love ever did was break and burn and end. That's just a great lyric. Put that on I wouldn't want that on a t-shirt necessarily. It's a little depressing, but it's so concise and really captures that emotion. Again, she's got such confidence in her songwriting that she can use these 2-cent words to convey these million-dollar concepts. It's the phrasing of the lyrics. It's the way she places them. It's just good songwriting. And I mean, I guess I don't need to, for any Swifties watching, I guess I don't need to preach to the choir and tell you she's a good songwriter. But that was just extra brilliant for me. And having that as the last song on the original version of the album is just like, that's such a wonderful way to end this album. But we're not done, because I'm going to listen to all the bonus tracks as well. So this is where it gets a little clunky. So I'm going to start in and listen to the first 4 of those extra tracks, and then we're going to listen to the last 10 on the next reaction video. So let's roll up our sleeves and get to the bonus tracks. This is the Moment I Knew.
Thank you. should have been there. Should have burst through the door with that baby I'm right here smile, and it would have felt like a million little shining stars had just aligned, and I would have been so happy. Christmas lights glisten, I've got my eye on the door, just waiting for you to walk in, but the time is ticking. People ask me how I've been as I comb back through my memory, how you said you'd be here. You said you'd be here. And it was like
textbook version of a confessional song, and it captures a feeling that I'm sure almost everybody has experienced at one point or another, being stood up and feeling stranded at a social event because you were expecting to experience it with someone else. And in this case, she extrapolates from that implicitly that their relationship is over, or that she's done with it, or something of that nature. And I think most of us have probably experienced that feeling of, I'm done. That person didn't show up, I'm done. And this is such a good encapsulation of that feeling, that dreadful, dreadful feeling of being stood up and having to unravel in front of, or fearing that you will unravel in front of, a bunch of strangers or a bunch of people that you're not comfortable unraveling in front of. So I really got into that lyric a lot. Two notes. I kind of did start laughing, and I had to, like, because it was a sad moment and it's like a sad song, but I was wondering if she was doing one of her little, she was doing a little songwriting trick where she said she went to the bathroom. Oh God. She went to the bathroom and then she had a sinking feeling. A little dad joke in there, Taylor. For such a sad song, it just seemed like such an odd little joke, if that's what that was, for her to place in there. And then the other thing was that the chorus, the instrumentation, especially in the chorus, really did seem to be the way that they soundtrack things that are happening in slow motion while she's talking about it, sounding like slow motion. It almost sounded like the Chariots of Fire. It was like, it was that kind of like echoey, slowed down type of audio effect that I found. It was like, at first I was conflicted. At first I thought it was like, oh God, they're actually mimicking a slow motion in the song. That's a little cheesy. But then realizing that it still fit with the song, and that the song really already sounded that way, I got a lot more comfortable with it. And then I thought, oh, that's actually kind of clever. But for the first couple of seconds, I was like, that was cheesy. But I came around to it. Well, I'll just say this now. Probably any one of these songs could have replaced that Snow Patrol song. I would have been perfectly happy with this being track, was it track 10 instead of the original one.
You said it in a simple way, 4 a.m. the second day. How strange that I don't know you at all. We stumbled through a long goodbye, one last kiss, then catch your flight. Right when I was just about to fall, I told myself, don't get attached, but in my mind, I play it back.
That song was perfectly well executed. I liked the background vocals that she was layering in there. There's nothing wrong at all with that song. There's just nothing incisive about it, really. It does capture that feeling of longing for someone who is out of town and you want to be with them, but it doesn't explore those feelings in a way that seems new or different for me. So I can understand why this didn't make the original cut of the album. I think that maybe my favorite song on the album so far. That's like an electropop style that just is really right up my alley. I like the little vocal manipulation, the little and I love how producers play with the audio of the song to make it sound tinny and abrupt in the transitions, but it's all contributing to the effect of the song. This is very different from anything else on the album. On the big tentpole singles, she employed the Max Martin production tricks, but she took a step back with the songwriting, and the production tricks really just kind of served as a means of pushing a specific sound out to the world, a different backing sound for Taylor Swift. Here, the production is purposeful and actually advances the narrative of the song. It's not just a way of saying, oh, here's Taylor doing a different sound. This is Taylor using her typical wordy, in fact, it's even more wordy than usual, lyrical style. She's taking a very self-consciously intellectual approach to, like, the word choice, and everything is very much, let's contemplate what is the best way to proceed in this situation. I think those word choices are very purposeful in showing that she's switched her emotional switch off and she's got her analytical switch on in order to navigate this particular situation where she could easily, like, lose herself in it. I just love how the lyric and the instrumentation and the production work together to really bring out the humor in the song. They feed off of each other. The production, the high-tech production, and Taylor's lyrics really play off of each other. On the other ones, it seems like Taylor took a back seat in her lyricism and sort of said, okay, I'll do a sort of a generic poppy vocal so that the bright poppiness of the song can take center stage. But here she's really writing an interesting lyric and co-starring with the interesting progressive production sound style that's being used with the song. Our last track in part two of the reaction for this album, and this should be a pretty easy listen for me because this is just the acoustic version of the opening track of the album, State of Grace, which is another one of my favorites off the album. The original was so soaring, and like I described it as being like a U2 type record, I think that having a contrasting stripped down acoustic version will be revealing. And so let's just see what it will be revealing of. I suspect it's just going to reveal, you know, some of the nooks and crannies of the song that weren't quite as obvious with the big production in the original version.
Walking fast through the traffic lights, busy streets and busy lives, and all we know is touch and go. We are alone with our changing minds. We fall in love till it hurts or bleeds, or fades in time. And I never saw you coming. And I'll this is the golden age of something good. This is the worthwhile fight. Love is a ruthless game unless you play it good and right.
The one thing that playing the stripped down version of the song revealed to me is where was the melody that this reminds me of. The melody of this reminds me of We Found Love by Calvin Harris and Rihanna. I try to always say her name right. So there's a certain similarity in the melody that she's using in the verses of the song to the chorus of We Found Love. And I heard it, but with all the other stuff going on in the song, in the original version, I just couldn't hone in on it. And here I heard it very clearly. I think this works better with the full production version versus the acoustic version. I think there's a majesty to the song and a sort of expansiveness to the song that needs all of that instrumentation to fill in the gaps. Here, I feel like I'm always a little more critical toward the end of these videos because maybe my attention span is dwindling, but I just felt like the gaps in between the lyrics here were not filled up. Like, I almost felt my attention wander in between times when she was singing, because it was basically the guitar trailing off. And I'm like, okay, nothing's going on for about 5 seconds. And I'm not so captivated by the lyrics that I'm just waiting for the next one to pop up on screen. Whereas in the full-on version, there's, you know, you stay afloat because of this sea of sound that you're floating on. That was a pretty good metaphor, right? So I like the original version of that better. This is not bad, and it's pretty. I just think the song works better as a big bombastic song the way I heard it the first time. So that's what I have to say about that. I'm going to reserve any final judgments on this album until we listen to the other 10 tracks that were on the version that was released in 2021. We're going to do that in the next reaction video. Thank you for your time and patience. If you made it this far, you are a trooper. Please like this video if you indeed liked it. There's quite a bit of effort and attention span on my part that's being expended, so a nice little acknowledgement would be great. If you feel so inclined, please subscribe to the channel. I'm doing the whole Taylor Swift discography, and I've got other videos, so it would be convenient for you even. This might even work out better for you, not just for me, if you subscribe to the channel. And as always, please make music better.